It looks like we hit the top of the hour. Let's get started. Thanks everyone for joining us today on our sensors and spray technology talk. What the guys are really going to get into today is which characteristics or aspects of a spray system are even worth sensing. Why do we want to do it? Why are they important to your overall process? It's going to be really fun. If any questions come up throughout the talk, please just shoot them up in the Q&A or in the chat. I'll be monitoring those and I'll interrupt the guys. They'll answer your questions live. We'll also do a few polls. Those will kind of be like based on industry, what kind of things you guys are interested in. That way the guys here, Paul and Kyle, can tailor this speech based on whatever you guys are interested in. It's gonna be really fun. So let's kick it off. Today joining us are PhD research engineer Kyle Bade and research engineer Paul Vesely out of the Spray Analysis and Research Services Group, which is a division of Spraying Systems Company. All right, I'm going to start the first poll and let Kyle take it away.
All right, thanks, Mary. As you guys sort of look at the poll here, this helps us to tailor some of the examples we might talk about or just better understand who's here and who we're talking with. But you know, what we're gonna talk about today are sensor basics. What is a sensor? What types of quantities do we expect to measure with a sensor? The idea of detail, both such as drop size and pattern, combined with more holistic quantities like flow rate and pressure, it's important to be able to sense all of these things. And moving towards a world in which we have knowledge of what our sprays are doing in real time is obviously very important. And so we're gonna touch on some of those quantities you would want to strive to look at, and then also why that's important. Sure, we can measure drop size, but why should you care, right? You're not necessarily spray researchers. You're often trying to manufacture a product or successfully run a process. And so it's important to understand not only what sensors can be valuable and what quantities are valuable, but then why does it make a difference in your processes or applications? All right, Mary, we can go to the next slide.
All right, cool. And then here are some of the results from the poll in case you guys want to kind of focus on maybe that chemical processing, food and beverage, and maybe even share some others that people are interested in.
Sounds good.
Cool.
So really the way we want to craft the message today is on sensor basics, but what is a sensor? We want to expand the idea of what a sensor can be. Typically, when I think of a sensor, it's something simple, small, and a lot of times operating simply doesn't necessarily mean that there is complexity behind the scenes. And so we want to expand the idea of a sensor to more than just say a flow rate and a pressure and a temperature, these sort of basic quantities, but also to more interesting details about a spray, temperature, drop size, pattern, you know, these more complex, like, values that often require more of an instrument than a sensor. But what if we can package some of these types of instruments to deliver these values very simply and easily and quickly, and then, you know, basically packaging them as a sensor? So we're going to go through some of the types of instruments or sensors we've developed to try to do that. Where they're used, any of these applications, right? We saw the poll, and there's a lot of chemical manufacturing and food, but also paper and all the different spray applications are obviously very important when we talk about sensors and why we might use them to monitor our processes, to tune the process, to evaluate the successfulness of the process in real time, and try to maintain a good quality product or deliverable in the end. So with that, I think we could probably go to the next slide and talk about more of the detailed characteristics we might try to look at.
All right, and with that comes our second poll. We're going to find out which of these spray measurements you guys are most intrigued in.
See if I can't motivate that a little bit. So spray pattern is obviously very important. You know, knowing where your spray is going, how wide is the spray coverage. That could mean you're spraying onto a passing by substrate on a conveyor, or it could be in a tower where you really want to use the entire volume of that tower and make sure that you're not leaving dead areas within that tower. And that could be achieved through testing to understand better what the spray is doing, as well as potentially like CFD modeling, like we do at Spraying Systems, to track the spray through the process and make sure that the entire area that's available is being used in the spray process. So the pattern's obviously very important. The pattern can be shaped and we'll talk a bit about that on the next slide, or a few slides later. Flow rate and pressure, combine this with temperature to really understand what's entering the nozzle, how it's being run. This is sort of operating condition or initial information about the material that's being sprayed, is obviously very, very important. Pressure is sort of the most common known parameter about a spray and how it's operating. Flow rate is one step up. It's often a bit more complex to measure. It requires a bit more expensive sensors or gauges. But flow rate is going to be very important, obviously, because if you're trying to deposit a material or process a certain amount of liquid material, then it's absolutely critical what the flow rate is, how much material you're using or putting down, as opposed to what pressure are you using to atomize it. So both of these quantities are very, very important. Temperature will obviously have a very big effect, because this will affect the spray's viscosity, the density, the surface tension, and this can control the size of the droplets, the quality of the pattern, the spray angle, which is the next thing we'll talk about. So temperature has sort of an indirect effect on everything about a spray and can be very important. And often temperature is one of the first things we turn to if we don't have a spray that's producing or a nozzle that's producing a really good spray. By increasing the temperature, we can reduce the viscosity and allow that material to potentially spread out a bit more. Spray angle, a bit self-explanatory, how wide is the spray, which goes hand in hand with the spray pattern or coverage. And then drop size, last but not least. And so drop size is obviously a very critical parameter. The smaller the drops are, the more they'll interact with the environment. So if you're trying to humidify or condition a gas or generate a chemical, these are all very critical processes to have small droplets typically. But large droplets can also be very important. If you're trying to clean a tank, for example, larger droplets will have more impact, and we'll talk about that a bit more.
All right.
Again, feel free to put any questions in the chat as we go to. We'll try our best to answer and keep it a conversation if we can.
Yeah, so not surprising here, spray pattern. Kyle, you were a very good influencer. Nice work. Drop size, flow rate, and looks like a little bit of pressure and spray angle. Very cool. And before we move on, we have someone who put in a cute question. Can you give a brief definition on your delineation between a sensor and an instrument?
That's a great question. And when we started to put this talk together, this is something we saw as a real need to define this better. And what we're trying to do is change the answer a little bit. When I think of a sensor, it has to be simple. It should be easy to deploy. It should be somewhat hands-off usually, I think. You know, so you sort of put it in the spray or put it in a process and it feeds back some information. An instrument, I would imagine, takes a bit more hands-on approach and the user is more manually extracting data. Oftentimes the instrument needs to be tuned a bit more. It can tell you more information. It can be more versatile, but it does require some expertise or some hands-on time. That's how I would define it, at least in the sense of what we're doing here. So spray pattern, you know, we had a lot of interest in that. It's great. So the different types of patterns we might look at, actually on the next slide, we've got a few images, so I'll hold off on that. But for quality control, obviously maintaining a good quality pattern is very important. You know, anytime you're producing an application or running an application, you may start with a nozzle. It may look something like this with a hollow cone. Over time, that nozzle can wear out. The material can build up on the nozzle itself. Other process parameters might change. Something could change and influence the pressure, for example, or the flow rate that's coming through the nozzle. All of these will have effects on the spray. A nice round spray like this might turn into something that's a bit more streaky with high and low points throughout the ring, for example, if something happens with the pattern or you have some buildup on the nozzle itself. So if you have solids content, that can really cause buildup or further erosion. So watching and monitoring the pattern can be very critical. And we'll have some ideas on how we can help to monitor that in process in a little bit. Determining the spray health through monitoring, this ties back to being more of a sensor where you've got something online running that can really feedback information on the process as opposed to something that you go and manually take data with, for example. And product development process changes. You know, a lot of people are using nozzles like this, but what if you're developing something more like a consumer product, a consumer spray bottle or product or something where you have these sprays or formulations that are changing very often, and it's important to understand what the spray is going to do before you deploy this to an actual application. So in the product development process, it's obviously very critical to understand what the spray pattern's doing and how it might change over time.
Yeah, I wanna put out this question just for you guys. I think we'll talk about pressure a little bit later, but we do have a question. What is the relationship between densities of fluid to be sprayed and fluid pressure?
Yeah, I think we will talk on that a bit later. Paul, you can chew on that a bit and come back to it, I think.
Sounds good.
Okay. So here we have some spray pattern type examples. There are many more, but this really, I think, gives a good summary of how we would refer to spray patterns. So first off, we have a solid stream. Here we have some flow control inside of the nozzle itself to maintain a liquid jet. Obviously very good for high impact. You're not even atomized at this point. You have a liquid jet that's reaching the surface with a very high impact time momentum as it cleans the surface. Oftentimes these sprays will be rotated throughout a tank or other applications so that you can clean an area or volume within something that's been dirty or has some buildup on it. A flat spray is similar in that it's very directed often, but it does have breakup and fans out into an atomized sheet. Flat sprays are good for conveyorized applications where you're sweeping a product or a substrate underneath the nozzle. They can be very useful in overlapping multiple nozzles to cover a larger target. And the atomization is often quite small. So the liquid is first formed into a liquid film, a thin sheet, which then atomizes into ligaments and droplets. A hollow cone, it's actually pretty similar to a flat spray, except you've sort of got an axisymmetric round flat spray. And so you end up with this more of a hollow cone spray pattern. A hollow cone compared to the next spray, number four, a full cone, a hollow cone will tend to have smaller droplets because of that pre-filming process. A full cone is useful in obviously many applications. Anything with a tower in it is going to use more of a full cone spray, where you want to maximize the interaction of the gas and the liquid, and therefore you want the filled in spray pattern. Hydraulic mist is similar to a full cone or a hollow cone, but you're really running at higher pressures, and the nozzles themselves are designed to be run at higher pressures, generating smaller droplet size. As you can see here in the image, if you compare the full cone to the hydraulic mist, the very, very small droplets of the hydraulic mist nozzle are allowing the droplets to first form a cone pattern, but then gravity takes over and those droplets just fall straight down because they're so small, they lose their momentum due to drag forces very quickly. And then two fluid nozzles, anytime you have a gas and a liquid that are mixing either internally or externally to the nozzle body, you have this sort of two fluid atomization process that can then be formed into different shapes, full cones, flat sprays, hollow cones, any of the ones we've talked about.
Awesome, thanks, Cal. We got a question coming in. Does a full cone spray have a constant drop density from the middle of the cone to the fringe?
Great question. The answer is no. I've spent quite a bit of time with clients discussing this, and there are nozzles that are designed to have a more uniform density or volume distribution throughout the pattern, especially with flat sprays. We have unique nozzles that are designed to have a more even distribution, and so one nozzle is designed to cover the target. But if you're going to be overlapping multiple nozzles, that could be with a flat spray or a full cone. Anytime you're going to overlap the patterns to cover more area, having a decreasing distribution of droplets as you go towards the spray edges is actually advantageous because it's a bit more forgiving when those sprays overlap and have to form a sort of a combined contribution from multiple nozzles. But you'll certainly generally have less droplets near the spray edges, especially with a full cone. So before we start, Mary, if we could pause the video and just go back to the beginning real quick. So this is an instrument or sensor that we've developed called our Spray Scan MPT and MPT for Mobile Patternator. And this instrument or sensor, depending on how you use it, is designed to allow a user to measure the details of a spray pattern very quickly and easily. I like using both terms for this one because you can set it up manually and really measure spray, but it's also designed to be very automated in the way that it processes the results. And we'll get back to that later. So We can play the video, which shows some of the hardware as well as the software and how we might assess a spray pattern using this type of system. So it's designed to be very mobile. Here you can see a system. So we have a frame with a laser, and we take a simple picture or video of that spray. And then in the software, which can be running right there on the tablet, you're able to see the pattern. The software identifies the pattern and then quickly creates this sort of distribution based on the intensity of the laser light, which is based on the amount of spray present across that spray pattern. So all of this can be done in less than a minute once you've used the instrument a couple times. And we'll move on to the sensor version a little later. So the software itself has some tools to manipulate and analyze the distribution of the liquid a little bit in a few different ways. This can be very helpful if you're assessing different liquid materials. It can be helpful if you're thinking of changing the nozzle type and want to look at the differences in spray angle or uniformity across the pattern, for example. And then also there's a built-in comparison tool to allow you to compare, say, the original new nozzle spray pattern to a used nozzle spray pattern. So having this ability to compare the two and decide if it's time to switch out a nozzle or not, it can be very useful.
Yeah, we got a great question in too. Can we get this video? Of course, I will put the link to our YouTube channel, which has all these videos and some more, into the chat so everybody can get it.
Excellent.
We'll have another follow-up too before we kind of move on to Paul's section. Do you think sensors can inform nozzle placement unique to a process?
Absolutely, absolutely. Especially if the spray is changing over time, depending on the spray itself or the nozzle type or the spray material, you could see over time if there's buildup or maybe a reduction in pressure for some reason, the spray angle could be changing, and you may want to make a real-time adjustment to the spray pattern or if you have the capability or positioning of the nozzle to accommodate maintaining the process running while still producing a good product or having a successful process. And you know, if you've got, say, a one-shift goal and the nozzle spray pattern is changing over time, you could certainly make adjustments to accommodate that if you're monitoring it as the spray is being run. With that, I'll turn it over to Paul for a few other thoughts on some different types of sensors.
All right. Yeah, thanks, Kyle. That was a great explanation on spray pattern and the lead into this. So nozzles are a special engineered orifice, right? That gives us a very specific, specific spray patterns and what we're looking for. And they're also a restriction device, a flow restrictor. So flow rate and pressure are important characteristics when it comes to any liquid delivery process and trying to dispense a liquid onto a substrate, like for food coatings or mixing liquids in tanks or in towers for chemical reactions or blending and such. So nozzles are designed to restrict flow, and it takes a pressure drop across the nozzle to dispense a certain amount of fluid. And obviously the liquid characteristics have an important place in how that's going to work out. So measuring flow rate and pressure are going to be very important for most spray processes. There's a manual and automated ways of making these kind of measurements using sensors. Thinking of a flow rate manual method would be collecting a volume of liquid dispensed out of a nozzle over a period of time and then measuring that, and then you get an average of flow rate that is dispensed out of that nozzle during that amount of time. So it's a great way to do spot checks on nozzles to test them for if they're worn out versus new ones. We do this kind of testing all the time working with customers, and I know our sales reps do as well. And detecting when nozzles are worn and when they need to be replaced or maintained, cleaned, clogging is also another issue that could happen with nozzles and is very important to processes. Other manual flow rate measurements would be like a rotameter, where you can have a sensor that's always giving you real-time data, but it takes a manual look at the sensor to know when things are going right. Automated flow meters can be pretty expensive. They range in an array of technologies, and they have their uses, pros and cons for sure, and the applications that they work best for. Some of the higher end flow meters are like Coriolis flow meters, very accurate, and work with a wide range of applications, but they can be pretty pricey. But they give you real-time measurements, very accurate. They can connect with control systems and are quite versatile tools. Other types of flow meters, automated ones, are electromag and Vortex and all sorts of, you know, turbine flow meters, and I'm sure there's quite a few more ultrasonic. So those are all very good sensors and a great way to keep up on how much fluid is being dispensed through your spray process, helping to identify when there's issues, and also just knowing, you know, detecting those worn nozzles and replacing them to, so you're not overusing water or chemical and wasting money and being more sustainable. Pressure is another important parameter. The pressure drop across the nozzle is going to determine that, and the fluid properties are going to determine how much, and the orifice size, of course, or how much liquid's going to be spent out of that nozzle. So pressure gauges and sensors are generally quite a bit cheaper than flow meters. So manual pressure measurements can be done with analog or board-on-tube pressure gauges. And then automated pressure measurements can be done with transducers and transmitters, pressure transmitters, piezoelectric pressure transmitters are all great sensors and a great way to monitor the inputs into a nozzle to know when either the nozzle is starting to wear out. If you have a constant flow going to your nozzle at all time and the pressure is dropping off, that's another way to detect that the nozzle orifice is getting worn out. Or if the pressure is building up on you and you got a positive displacement system, then you know that maybe the nozzle's clogging up on you. It needs some attention. All right, next slide. So pressure versus flow. The flow rate is proportional to the square pressure. So as the pressure is increasing, that flow rate's increasing with it. And that's a great way to help kind of size a nozzle. This kind of information is in our nozzle catalogs. And it's all based around water, but it's a great tool to help size and to select a nozzle for your spray application when you're looking at just pressure and flow. But one thing to keep in mind is that that flow rate to the proportion of the square pressure is not always true. Nozzles are special engineered instruments or devices that are doing more than just restricting flow rate. You know, they're creating a specific spray pattern, as Kyle presented. Different fans, shapes, and such. So that definitely is going to impact the orifice geometry, and the internals to the geometry inside the nozzle that are creating those special spray patterns are going to impact that. You're going to reduce that amount of flow that's going to come out of that nozzle with respect to your input pressure. So keep that in mind. So here's some flow exponents you can use for future reference for that. There was a question earlier about the density of the fluid and how does that impact specific gravity. It definitely does, right? So think of your pressure and flow as, your flow rate as mass, right? You got amount of, your mass is how much flow is coming out of the nozzle, and your pressure is your potential energy, that pressure drop. So if your specific gravity is higher of that liquid, and you got the same amount of energy available to you to atomize it, or to push it out of the nozzle, you'd expect you would get less flow rate out of the nozzle when you have a specific gravity higher than water. Good one. All right, Mary, next slide.
Before we move on, you've triggered some awesome discussion points. Cool. This attendee recognizes this question might be outside of the scope of the webinar, but just in case, do you have recommendations for sensors that might detect objects or targets to trigger flow? If so, do you have resources? If you do, then we can put them in the chat or answer later. What do you think, Paul?
So sensors to detect like a substrate, like something moving by, and then trigger a nozzle to spray. Is that kind of what we're talking about?
It sounds like it. Yeah, like triggers the flow.
Yeah, we have an array of automated spray nozzles and control systems. We have our PulsaJet spray line or nozzle line. These are electrically actuated nozzles that work with that utilize pulse width modulation, and they work with AutoJet spray controllers. And these spray controllers work with all sorts of different sensors. They work with line encoders, so the duty cycle of the PWM can be ramped up and down as the line speed changes. And they also have sensors that detect, either like bread pans or sheets of material that are passing by, candy bars and such. So these sensors, there's an array of sensors available for that. Ones that use like lasers to detect, or or seeing eye sensors and such like that. So there's definitely an array of technology available. And they send a trigger signal when it detects the substrate and the pulse jet nozzle sprays. And then once that object's passed, then it stops spraying. So it's a nice way to conserve your material, because a lot of our materials that you guys are spraying are, you know, very expensive or just take a lot of work to prepare. So.
All right, awesome. We got another one. How important is pressure and flow gauge locality in regards to nozzle performance indicators?
Yeah, great. Thanks for catching that. That's a miss on my part. So flow rate, mass flow rate, volume flow rate, you wouldn't expect that to change much, you know, anywhere in your fluid delivery system, as long as it's in line between where you're sourcing your liquid from, pump, pressure tank, whatever the case is, to the nozzle. So a flow meter could be installed for a single nozzle before that nozzle, or it could be monitoring a header of nozzles per se. Pressure, you should measure pressure, as close as possible to the inlet of the nozzle, as you see in this picture. A lot of times when we're talking to customers about the pressure of their system, when we're helping them optimize and kind of set up and develop their new spray processes, a lot of times they're measuring pressure at the pump. And pump discharge pressure is extremely important, because you're very worried about the life, the usage of that pump and the wear life of that. So that's makes complete sense. But when we're talking about the actual pressure going through the nozzle and what the expected flow rate's going to be, and the performance of that nozzle, we should be measuring that. We should know what that delta pressure is there, but from to the inlet of the nozzle to the atmosphere that you're spraying into. So just like we're showing here in this picture, it's definitely ideal to be measuring your inlet pressures right there at the inlet of the nozzle.
All right, awesome. I'm going to move on to the next slide while we kind of answer this next question. Last question on flow and pressure. Can this person purchase an internal mix nozzle with both flow rates for air and fluid monitored?
Monitored. So internal like, mix. Yeah. Go ahead.
Could they put like a, this flow rate pressure sensor on there, and could both air and fluid be monitored with that sensor or with that system?
Paul, I think you're gonna get to this in
one slide. Yeah. Well, internal mix. Yeah. Just in general, internal mix nozzles. You got your fluid that you're atomizing, your liquid you're atomizing, and the atomization gas are mixing inside the nozzle. So generally, they're going to be at this close to the same pressure. Those two the fluids entering the nozzle. The flow rates would have to be measured independently for the atomizing air versus the liquid that you're atomizing. But it's good to measure both of those at the inlet of the nozzle. But you'd expect for most air atomizing nozzles, or the pressure for both those fluids are going to be near the same at the inlet of the nozzle. There are some air atomizing nozzles that are internal mix. They have a larger turn down ratio, so you will get a range of liquid pressures you can work with the same inlet air atomizing nozzle. Like our Flowmax nozzles are an example of that. All right. So. Monitoring pressure and flow are very key to monitoring the health of that nozzle of your spray process. Things change so much. Your nozzles wear out. A lot of things happen. Kyle already talked about spray pattern. Spray pattern definitely changes. We saw an example of that, worn nozzle versus new nozzle using the spray scan MPT. But it makes a big difference. It changes your spray angle. It changes the amount of fluid that's coming out of it generally. You output more liquid on your nozzle as your nozzle wears out. And it'll change drop size, and we'll talk about that a little later too. Generally increases drop size, which may be not beneficial for a process, for the spray process. All right, next. Temperature. So nobody was interested in temperature, but we're going to cover one minute here, 30 seconds of it. But temperature is important, and for a lot of liquids that are very low viscosity, like water, it doesn't make a very significant change in what the spray plume looks like, and the spray angle, and the flow rate coming out of the nozzle. A little difference, but it's not very significant. But for fluids with a little bit higher viscosity, think of vegetable oils all the way on up to glues that are very high viscosity, tens of thousands of centipoise, chocolates, fluids with high solid content. Temperature can be a very big important parameter and how that nozzle is going to spray. Some fluids viscosity changes very greatly, pretty quickly, like exponentially as temperature changes. So even just a few degrees temperature difference can really impact how much liquid's coming out of your nozzle, what that spray pattern is, spray angle, and drop size. So we see this a lot in like spray dry applications and such. It's very critical to keep a constant temperature down and what that you can plan around, so that spray process is producing the end result that you're looking for. All right. So Spring Systems has a new system that's coming out this summer called the Spray Scan Mobile Sustainability Monitor. And this instrument here is it's a measurement system. It's a monitoring system. It doesn't do any controls, but it has a small sensor package that's got a flow sensor, pressure sensor, temperature sensor all built in with a very nice touchscreen here that's connected by data cables. So the flow sensors or the sensor package is designed to be installed very near to your spray process, either at the inlet of your header of nozzles or at fairly close to the inlet of the nozzle, so we can get accurate pressure measurement. And then the monitor is set off on the side. And Mary, you can play the video here. The system can be just give you real-time measurements, or it at the same time. Oh, let it go here, and I'll talk. So this system, as a standalone system, you can use it as just a real-time measurement system, a nice low-cost entry-level point into measuring the input parameters of that liquid into your nozzle. And also you can set this system to monitor for a set application. You can select your nozzle, you can select the number of nozzles and the inlet pressure or the expected pressure drop, flow rate and temperature that you're expecting out of your spray process. And this will give you a nice visual alert and real-time information and historical data of those values when they deviate out of the tolerance range of what you're looking for. And it's just a nice way to kind of keep a visual eye on your spray process. This system also, you can go to the next slide, Mary, does connect to a server as an optional add-on and transmits the data to the server, pressure, temperature, and flow, and has a really nice online portal for viewing the data in real time and also the historical data. So you can look back at what the inputs into your nozzle were, going back days, months, years. So if this week my quality department says the product is bad from, starting at this time, from last week, you can go back and look at the data and try to identify, well, what happened to my spray process? Why is this product being rejected by quality? So this is a great way to monitor how your spray process is happening over time with this data logging, and use it to help make refinements. If your plant temperature changes throughout the day and throughout the months and the year, it's a great way to see how that affects your spray process. If your fluid delivery system is inconsistent because there's a lot of different points of where sprays are coming off of it, and you wanna see how that monitor, how one nozzle is affected by that, this historical data is a great way to monitor that and make adjustments and improve your process. This is also a good way, we can set alarms in this online dashboard here to notify you by email or text message when you start to deviate out of that target range that you're looking for. So it's a good way to just keep an eye on nozzle wear and other issues that could happen, clogging of nozzles or downstream fluid delivery issues. So this system here, we're field testing now and working towards planning for production, and we're looking to have this system available later this year.
Awesome. All right, Paul, we got a question for you. Can you use gases with the spray scan sustainability monitor?
I'm sorry, one more time with the question?
Yeah, can you use gases or measure gases?
Oh yeah, not right now. So right now it's gonna be a tool to measure just liquid only nozzles or the liquid inlet into an air atomizing nozzle. But it's in the plan for the future of adding a sensor package that will also have a pressure and flow sensor for the atomization gas as well.
Awesome.
So yeah, in the future, but we're not there yet.
Great. So Kyle is going to take it away from here too. He mentioned that we would be talking about an automated system for the pattern. And a question came in right after your talk to Kyle. Since you can measure the pattern, can you also determine impact of the nozzle? And if so, what would you use?
Sure, maybe we could pause the video and we, but yeah, about measuring impacts, impact is going to be a combination of droplet size or the mass and the velocity. So it's this, it's that momentum change or acceleration as the droplet hits its target. So we can really, we can make some assumptions about the mass distribution using a spray distribution, but the velocity distribution, the velocity of the droplets is something that's a little bit more difficult to assess through a purely laser system like this, where we're looking at the intensity of the laser light. There are ways to assume the velocity in certain situations where you could probably make that conversion, but directly, no, we wouldn't be measuring impact.
All right, awesome. Thanks, Kyle.
Yeah, so like I talked about, we wanted to convert this type of a system to a more of a sensor arrangement. And so what you see here is a fully automated setup where, if we can just, Mary, if we just want to start it over, that might be the easiest. So we have a fully automated setup of the spray scan MPT here, where it's going to actually detect when a spray is present. And so as this robot does its job, in between coating the targets here, the pans, the baking tins, for example, it goes and checks its spray. The system automatically evaluates that spray pattern and then also sends this information to a cloud dashboard. And so this can trigger process changes. It can trigger alerts or alarms about the process. You know, if you start to develop a streak or a poor spray pattern let's say using an automotive application, you know, before this robot goes in and completes 100 vehicles, you could really detect that there's a problem and make a change very quickly. This is a screen of the online dashboard where we're measuring, you know, pressure, flow, temperature, as well as the spray pattern coverage width, the uniformity across the pattern. We can set threshold values to trigger the alarms or the process changes. And so all of this is done in full automation. And really, that's the differentiating factor that we talked about in the beginning. So we start to see this more as a sensor that lives online, doing its job and sending information back to the process, as opposed to being more of a research instrument or something you'd use on the front end of a process development. And so this system can have an onboard embedded system in it, so that all the processing happens right there at the process without any of user input to make it happen. So moving on to drop size, this is obviously another very critical parameter. It's important in many processes. Smaller droplets will interact with the gas stream around it more quickly, more effectively. They will also coat a target's substrate more uniformly, but larger droplets will have larger mass transfer, higher impact, and more momentum as they move through a process. So it's important to understand what type of drop size you're after. Too small of droplets can be caught up in drift. This is a huge problem in agricultural applications, and I'm sure other industrial manufacturing processes as well. So you don't often want too small of droplets, but you also don't want too large of droplets. So understanding droplet size and measuring it and monitoring it real time through a sensor type instrument can obviously be very important. So towards that, we've actually developed a system that it, again, takes more complex, and we can go to the next slide, Mary. It takes more complex drop sizing concepts, simplifies it, packages it in a small package, and then allows drop size to be monitored in real time. Again, throwing alerts and letting process controllers know if something has happened within the spray. So we can play, I think we have a video. So this is our MDS or mobile drop size analyzer. The equipment itself is very simple. This is actually a prototype version that you see here. The latest system is actually smaller than this, and we have some users now that are testing and trying this out. So if anyone's interested, you know, please reach out to us. But we're monitoring the drop size in real time. We can detect changes in the drop size. We can focus on specific statistics, such as, you know, a Dmax or a D32. monitor those, set threshold values for alerts, and either trigger warnings or alerts for the process controllers, or actually trigger process changes if that's you also have an archive, so you can go back and and what might have been going on as we work through this. So this is our spray scan MDS. A few drop size statistic definitions. It feels like a more complete message if we go through a couple of these. The more common, you know, it's important to understand that each spray nozzle generates a range of droplet sizes. As you can see here with the gray bars, the range for this particular spray was about from somewhere close to zero up to right around 100 microns. We can put on a few statistics on the curve there. And you know, the DV 0.1, 0.5, and DV 0.9 are volume-based statistics indicating what size droplets contain that amount of volume. D-min and max are some pretty straightforward indicators of what were the minimum size and maximum size. But the volume-based statistics are often the most important for coding applications where you really care how much of my volume, my sprayed volume, was contained in these size of droplets. And that's often a better statistic is a volume-based average like a DV 0.5 rather than something like a straight average of the droplet size. That would be a D10. And then relative span factor is an indication of how wide is that distribution as opposed to a very narrow drop size distribution. Then we have our counts based statistics, which are, like I said, D10. I think the most commonly used is a D32 or solder mean diameter, which is really a ratio of the surface area and volume of the sprayed material. So a smaller D32 will indicate much faster evaporation rates or gas conditioning interactions within a tower. So D32 and DV 0.5 are sort of, in spray process engineer terms, better, quote unquote, average. They're really weighted averages for droplet size distributions. And there's a lot more information on that we can share when the time comes or if someone's interested. Paul, I think you're going to pick up here for a few last thoughts before we wrap things up, right?
Yeah, thanks, Kyle. So one thing to keep in mind with nozzles is they're not all created equal. They have their specific function and what they're designed for. In this case, for drop size, you can see three nozzles here, an example. They all produce the same flow rate with respect to pressure. So, you know, just comparing them in the catalog and not knowing more than just those that bit of information, you may think that these nozzles are pretty equivalent, but the drop size produced by these nozzles is quite different, as we see on the plot on the right. So that's an important parameter to keep in mind. So, you know, nozzles, you know, they produce a certain flow rate for versus pressure. They also produce a certain type of spray pattern, and also they're designed to produce certain ranges of drop size. So it's a lot of things to keep in mind and are important for, we make hundreds of thousands of different nozzles because of that reason. There's so many different spray processes and all these different parameters are important for different processes. All right, next slide, Mary. So bringing it all together, you know, how's drop size change? How is it affected by these different other parameters that we talked about today about measuring with instruments sensors? We talked about, you know, flow rate. As we increase flow rates, we're outputting more mass of fluid out of the nozzle. And generally with the same nozzle, it's going to increase the drop size produced by that nozzle. Conversely, with pressure, you know, same thing. If we decrease pressure, we'd expect also that drop size would increase from that same nozzle. Spray angle, you know, if you use a flat fan nozzle, and we have a lot of different angles of those, you know, as you go from a higher angle nozzle, 110 degree, 90 degree, down to, you know, 50 degree or so, you'd expect with the, you know, the same capacity nozzle, the same orifice, you know, the same pressure and flow outputting the nozzle, you'd expect with a narrow angle flat fan nozzle that the drop size would increase. And temperature, that's, you know, temperature is energy. It's also potential energy like pressure. So as you decrease temperature, you'd expect your drop size to increase. And that's with low viscosity fluids and with high viscosity, you know, high viscosity, obviously it's going to be more drastic, you know, think of, you know, corn syrup, you know, it's heated, you know, nice and high, it's going to spray somewhat okay. And then as you, you know, start decreasing the temperature, it's going to become very hard to spray and the drop size is going to go up a lot and flow rate's going to go down and such. So these are definitely things to keep in mind. And it's just a way of comparing this here. All right, Mary, next slide.
Yeah, so just kind of wrapping it up here. We'd love to hear from you guys. If you guys have applications you're interested in, or if you want to share an application where you're like, I don't really know if this needs a sensor or not. Is this worthwhile? Are some applications more worthy of a sensor than others? While we're waiting for that, maybe we can just get a quick brainstorm from Kyle and Paul. Do you guys think all applications are worthy of a sensor? Are some more sensitive than others, and especially for certain sensors?
You know, simplicity is very important. So the sensors we've shown today are designed to be very simple, but they are measuring complex quantities. So it's a trade-off between adding a bit of complexity or by adding in a sensor. You need the sensor not to fail. You need the sensor to give you accurate measurements. But once you have that, I think that a critical process can really be relied on and optimized quite a bit more. So I think basically all applications can benefit. It's really a trade-off of cost and so a little bit of added complexity to include them.
Yeah, I agree. And you know, the as far as sensors go, the cheapest sensor of everything we talked about is usually around temperature and pressure are the two easiest and cheapest things to measure. Pressure being the most important for a spray process, that pressure drop across the nozzle. It's gonna, you know, knowing what that nozzle is and what it should output as a new nozzle, knowing what that pressure drop is, you know, in real time could be, you know, whether it's through a mechanical pressure gauge or something a little bit, you know, integrated into a control system or a monitoring system, that could be very beneficial. You know, as process things change and you can detect when, try to detect when things, you know, nozzles clogging or other issues are happening would be important for, you know, pretty much all spray applications.
Awesome. We did have one question from earlier too, regarding the spray scan mobile patternator. Can they use the laser in a plastic flight tube?
The answer is yes. Depending on the flight tube arrangement, we might have to make some customizations, but from what we've shown here to where we are today, we've done a lot of development. And so making the sensors smaller and compact and more automated, if you're in a controlled situation, like within a flight tube, then you could potentially really simplify things a lot because you're not then trying to accommodate any and all situations. So yeah, if you're interested, or you want to discuss that more, you know, contact us at spray.analysis@spray.com.
All right, that's great, guys. Got one message coming in here. Similar to the setup in the wind tunnel, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And it doesn't have to be a small spray. We can measure a much larger area.
Awesome. All right, well, thanks everyone for joining us. Please visit sprayanalysis.com, go to the virtual events tab and the webinars to register for our next one. That will be the state of oil and gas from a spray technology perspective. Joining us on that one will be a couple of our market development team leaders in the process industry. So that'll be pretty exciting. And Kyle put it in the chat and it's here too. If you want to learn anything more about the sensors or instruments, please visit sprayscan.com. And before we go, looks like we have one longer one. Do you guys want me to go ahead and read it for you?
Yeah, we'll stick around for cool. A few minutes if people have more questions, but great. I think that basically wraps us up. If people want to log off, that's fine.
Awesome. So this application requires us to use multiple spray nozzles for a variety of flow operations. Often we find ourselves verifying flows by looking at tables, and we've created a series of lookup tables and functions in Excel to interpret the data. Unless we are up to date, we usually stick to a few of the nozzles we know have worked in the past, at least before we spend the time to modify the tool. The question is, several vendors with specialty equipment applications have software available to design, to calculate, and predict the product that makes sense for the application. Do you have software available or have something in the works like this?
Well, we do have software that we call virtual overlap analysis that allows us to take spray patterns like what you saw generated by the spray scan MPT and virtually overlap the patterns to optimize the placement and distribution from multiple nozzles, if that answers the question. The benefit there is you're taking real data from a nozzle and designing based on that data, as opposed to a predicted distribution or predicted spray width or coverage.
Also,
just based on spray angles. So that's a great place to start, but having the actual distribution like what we showed here is obviously a big step forward. Yeah,
absolutely. And just looking at it from just the pressure and flow aspect of it, we have data tables in the product catalog based on water, but we're also some point later we're going to be releasing a new tool on our website for nozzle searching, where you can put in this information into a lookup, and it'll highlight the nozzles that would fit in the realm of what you're looking for. So you can input in, I'm looking to operate at this pressure and get this flow, and I'm looking for this range of drop size kind of thing, this kind of range of spray angle. So this is something that's in the works, so it is something that'll be out in the near future, but a little bit more user-friendly, a little bit more actionable kind of nozzle search kind of guide, which could be helpful with these design applications.
Awesome. Got another question coming in. Do you have case studies or resources for ag applications? I'll quickly browse through the website and answer that one on the side, if that's okay.
All right, I think we're all set. I'm going to reach out to Chris. I know Chris and I, we've worked together before, so
awesome.
We'll sync up.
Okay.
If that, if the attendee who's asking about resources for ag applications wants to stand by, I'll send a link over. Otherwise, thank you guys so much for staying and for chatting. We had a great time.
Yeah, thanks, Mary.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.